Good morning, good evening, and good afternoon to all of our friends live around the world. This is the .NET Doc Show. Oh, I'm your host, David Fine, along with Pam Sober, and our special guest for today, Mika Dumont. Mika,
Hi.
Why don't you say
hi, everyone. Yeah, my name is Mika, and I'm a program manager on the Roslyn team.
Awesome.
And yeah.
How long have you been a program manager on the Roslyn team? Because that seems like a lot. That seems like a lot of fun being a, you know.
Yeah, it is a lot of fun. So I've been a program manager for 2 years now in January. So yeah,
awesome.
And it's been a lot and it's exciting and I love what I do every day. So it's been really cool.
Cool. Someone mentioned robot voice. Is that, that's my voice coming through like a robot?
Yep. Yeah. Remember that one time?
I didn't want to interrupt, but yes, I thought it was maybe me. But no.
I thought it was mine also.
Okay, well, I'm going to drop and then come back, but someone has to continue the introduction, so it's not like officially a robot thingy all day. So I'll be back.
Oh. Live television.
What will we do without David?
Well, so we actually have a script that we read at the beginning of the show. Welcome to an hour of unscripted .NET entertainment. I am your host, not David Pine. I don't remember the rest.
Unscripted fun.
And yeah.
Daily dosage of .NET prescription. I don't know.
It's not like we've been doing this for a year or something.
I haven't done the script part though, so.
Well, and I'm trying to lead into David coming back. David, you're back.
And we have some things we are excited about today as well, right?
David, can we hear you?
Does it work?
We cannot hear you, David.
What? Nothing?
It does work. His magic review.
Oh, because of that bug that we found earlier in the pre-show. Okay.
All right. And I don't sound like a robot anymore, right?
So I can't hear you, Dave. So this is going to be hard for us to pull off with the cue. So how about I just talk and then I'll fix my audio.
Sounds good. Let's
so
do it.
So for everybody for our guests who might be wondering why we are in our finest dinner attire, it turns out that we are celebrating 1 year this week. We have been doing the .NET Doc Show for 1 year.
Time flies.
Okay, so there's my little audio bit. Now my audio is all screwed up, so why don't you guys get over to check up and do that. I'm going to refresh my browser and be back in a few seconds.
All right.
So let's go to check up then.
Look, that was the best intro.
This is a lot of fun so far. I'm really enjoying this hodgepodge of a hot mess for the 1 year anniversary. So awesome. We've got a checkup for today. And this is where we talk about some content that's relevant to our conversation with Mika. And take it away, Myra.
Yeah. So today, the topic that we chose was writer first analyzer and code fix. So Mika will be talking about the several analyzers that you can have, but if you have your own set of rules and you need to write your own analyzer, we have a tutorial for that. And so the topic will go over like what is the SDK that you need, what are the workloads on VS that you're gonna need to write your own analyzer, and then it's gonna start like show you how to write that analyzer and then run on your code and make the code fix. So we definitely like recommend that for you to give it a try. Did you work on this one, Mika?
This was here before I started. I've updated it a bit, or some of those docs as well. And yeah, I'm definitely going to go over that today. So,
okay. So we have that for people that want to go over and test it and give it a try. And we're excited to hear what Mika also has to share with us.
Oh, I'm just going to throw this up here. Someone says I look like Ryan Reynolds. I will take that all day long.
Noise.
Oh, that's funny. I know that I've been playing a lot with Roslyn too, with source generators just recently, but I love the APIs and I love that. I feel as though there is a bit of a learning curve, but you know, once you kind of bring yourself down to that little level, like a lower level, right, where it's, you have to be more considerate of like all the various APIs and the all the capabilities, like you can do so much with this stuff. It's really incredible. And this tutorial that Myra is sharing is a great example of that. So yeah, check it out. And should we jump into the hallway track already? Are we a little ahead of time, or what?
I don't know, but I imagine Mika can keep us entertained for, you know, 55 minutes. No pressure, Mika.
So this is the hallway track. Imagine a pseudo circle at your favorite developer conference. We're doing this virtually, so we've got Mika with us today, and she's going to be talking through the Roslyn analyzers, creating those things, some demo source code. We know everyone loves that. So feel free to ask questions here in chat, and we'll make sure that we try to address those to the best of our ability. So here's your screen, Mika.
Yeah, so I like to usually start off just talking about what Roslyn is. When I joined the team, I didn't know what it was. So for those of you that are unfamiliar with Roslyn, it is the code name for the C# and the Visual Basic compiler, where we built an open source API surface so that any developer can write really smart code-focused tools and technologies. And some of these tools and technologies are also known as analyzers. And analyzers is basically a tool that inspects your code and reports diagnostics and errors as you type. And these diagnostics, you know, typically manifest in the editor as squiggles. So if you're in Visual Studio or VS Code and you're on a given C# or Visual Basic file and you see squiggles, those are Roslyn analyzers running in the background. And analyzers also surface a light bulb or a screwdriver, which is also known as a code fix or a refactoring. So the best way to understand what an analyzer is to actually see an example. So you can see here is an example on my screen. So we have, you know, the squiggle letting you know that there's a violation. So that's part of the diagnostic. And then we also have the code fix, to fix the violation. So it's this light bulb here. And if we take a look at my error list, you see all of these analyzers I have running in the background and reporting violations in my code. And analyzers also have severities. There are three shown here. So there is an error, a warning, and an information severity. There's also a fourth severity called hidden or silent, but that wouldn't show up in your editor or your error list because it is hidden. And so using my error list, I can also navigate, you know, to these different analyzers or to these different diagnostics. And so the very first analyzer that I want to talk about is a code fix to simplify this conditional expression. So this did start off as just a single Boolean, but then it got pretty complicated. So in order to counteract this, we do have a code fix to simplify this conditional expression.
So that's a lot more readable now. That I really like that. So I'm curious. So there's a lot to kind of unpack there, right? So the analyzer itself is actually providing that squiggle and then like the little bulb thing that you clicked on, and then the text for that, it's actually running the analysis. But how does it know that it can be simplified?
So that's where you have, you know, the diagnostic ID that you can hook into the code fix. So because we have, you know, the analyzer that's running analysis, we do have a code fix that will like identify, you know, whether or not something can be, you know, simplified or specific analyzer. And I'll definitely show that as well in the demo, how to write, you know, a Roslyn analyzer with a code fix. And
awesome.
You know, because we do have these APIs that are open source, you know, into the compiler, then we can actually like understand, you know, what's going on and give you those tools to also write your own.
Awesome. That's cool.
Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, I mean, exactly as you said, David, like this just makes the conditional expression a lot easier to read, so it can be consumed by your team. And, you know, it's just a great analyzer to help with the quality of your code. And I want to also just show you these other two analyzers I have here because they're a bit different. So this one here is a suggestion. And this is letting me know that that this switch statement can also be converted into a switch expression. And so this analyzer is introducing new C# language features, and it's letting me know where I can leverage new language features throughout my code. So I can go ahead and accept this code fix to convert it to a switch expression. But because I really like this analyzer, I can also configure this and I can bump up the severity of this analyzer. So if I want, I can set this to, let's say, a warning, which will make it just a little bit more obvious throughout my code. And then my team can then see it, you know, as well, and use new C# language features. And the way that they can like see this, these severities as well, as through the editor config. So I don't know if you noticed, but when I did configure this, it kind of showed that this little editor config preview. So you see here that it's going to be updated to that. And this is an editor config file, in case you're unfamiliar with it, which is pretty much just a single file that lives at the root of your repository. And that's where you can, you know, document all of your code style or code quality analyzer preferences. And you can share it amongst your entire team. And once I update that and I, you know, commit and push my changes, then my whole team will start getting warnings to use a switch expression instead of a switch statement.
Cool. So yeah, the editor config, I understand, like you mentioned, is source control. So that's nice for teams sharing their preferences of coding styles and whatnot.
Yeah.
I did want to ask another question here specific to the switch expression. So when Visual Studio is recommending that, it must know what language versions are available for the contextual project that it's within, right? So it's not going to suggest something newer that it's not actually compatible with, right? So if you're like still on C# 6, for example, and that's what you're pinned to, it's not going to suggest a C# 9 feature. Is that right?
Yeah, exactly. You would have to just add that to your project properties and make sure that you are on the latest version of the C# language. And if you also use, you know, .NET 5, then if you have that SDK kind of pointing to that, to the .NET 5 SDK or later, you'll also just get them by default.
Awesome. We did have a question here. Dick Baker is asking, so what's the overhead with all of this wizardry working here in the background?
It's a good way to describe what's going on here.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so pretty much this is just running code analysis, and then there are these two different APIs that we have. So we have the syntax tree, and then we also have the semantic model. And so I was actually going to, I can talk about that a bit more, but so basically it has, you know, the two components of syntax tree, which is just a high representation of your code. So this includes all of your comments, white space, and end of line trivia. And then there is the semantic model, which basically contains any information related to the meaning of your program and the symbolic information that you need. And the way that these two components interact are through a question answer model. So from the syntax tree, if you have an array, let's say, and you wanna know, you wanna figure out what type that array is, you ask the semantic model, and then the semantic model will return an answer to you. So that's kind of what, these are the APIs that we sort of surface, and I'll show you also like how you can leverage them and use them as well. Yeah.
So for the overhead, to get, I guess, directly into that question, it's already part of what's happening behind the scenes anyways. So Roslyn, as I understand it, is compiling your C# code, and Visual Studio already has that as part of its IDE experience. It's already there. It's already built into it. So analyzers really kind of sit on the side and let, you know, with those APIs, let you express, you know, various intent, right? So you can say, you can look at the syntax tree and the semantic model, and you can infer things about it. But the overhead is kind of minimal unless you write a terrible analyzer that just continues to traverse itself over and over.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. And so that kind of also comes into the next analyzer that I wanted to show. So this analyzer is, it's actually built into our, it's like an analyzer that is built into the .NET 5 SDK. So we recently added all of our top recommended Roslyn and .NET analyzers, which contains a bunch of .NET code quality, security, and performance analyzers. So, you know, a lot of people have been asking for this. Before, you would have to just install like the Roslyn NuGet package to get a lot of these analyzers, or you would have to install FXCOP analyzers. But we now include that with the .NET 5 SDK. So if your project targets .NET 5 or later, you'll automatically get these analyzers. And if you are on older versions of .NET, you can go to your project properties page and you can still get them if you just select this enable .NET analyzers. So by default, if you're on .NET 5 or later, you'll get them. If not, you can enable them as well in project properties.
What? I didn't know that. That's so awesome.
Yeah, this is brand new. A lot of people have been asking for this. So we're really excited to have this. It's just a part of the SDK now instead of, you know, built into the tools of Visual Studio. So
I do know that they've dramatically improved through the years. Like I, for the longest time, was like a big user of ReSharper. And then I stopped using it. And then I feel like Visual Studio has, with the help of the Roslyn analyzers, has really come a long way in a short amount of time. And I get everything I need and more now from them. So that's awesome. And I just want to call attention to the fact that you're using emoji here in your switch statement.
Yeah.
And I love that. That's so cool.
Yeah, this is just a fun project that we built just for a demo. It was like right when, you know, we're all in quarantine. We're like, what's a fun game we can all play? So this is like a memory game that we created that you can just play online. So
awesome.
Yeah. So this analyzer, this just to like show you what this one does. So pretty much this will instantiate this argument exception correctly. And it's offering me just a code fix to go ahead and, you know, pass null. So those are like the three types of analyzers. And yeah, they're really cool. And I would definitely recommend just, you know, selecting that light bulb suggestion and seeing what it has to offer. Because we have like a lot of really awesome code fixes and refactorings. And yeah, and like another thing that I did want to mention is that one of the, I mentioned that, you know, analyzers also could have a hidden diagnostic that you wouldn't necessarily see, like you wouldn't see a squiggle and it wouldn't show up in your error list. But you will notice, you know, a screwdriver or a light bulb in the margin. And so, you know, if I go ahead and invoke these, you can see that I have these different refactoring options as well. For instance, I have extract base class. So if I want to quickly extract members from a class to a new base class, like I can do that through the screwdriver. And that's also powered by Roslyn Analyzers.
I did not know about that one either. That is going to be so helpful.
There's a bunch, and I'll definitely point to our docs on a bunch on all of our, you know, code fixes and refactoring. So there's a lot to learn.
So this is slightly, I'm sorry, Myra, go ahead.
Oh yeah, no, I just said it's amazing. Go ahead.
This is just slightly off topic, but it just occurred to me while you were talking. I always call it the screwdriver too, but is there an actual name for that UI hint?
It's our refactorings. So it's represented by the screwdriver.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Oh. And the light bulbs are like the code fixes or the quick actions, which will surface. If it's a code fix, it'll have like a red X. And then if it's a light bulb, it's a quick action, which will surface some of our refactorings as well and code fixes.
Refactorings. I'm going to have to remember that. Like the plural version plus an S. Refactorings. That's the official tool.
Yeah. I see we have a question, how I can ignore the rules that I deem as obsolete. Yeah, so,
and is that what you were showing before with the suppress and editor config edits?
Yeah, exactly. So I could just go to my editor config file. So I can either do it through the light bulb. So whenever I, let's say, have, you know, a squiggle or like a code fix that's offering me and I just, you know, don't really care, you can just configure those rules through the light bulb or the error list, or you can just do it directly within your editor config file. And the way you know, can add an editor config real quick is just going to add new item. And then we have this editor config. But we will automatically generate an editor config for you if you configure the severity through the light bulb or the error list menu. We will just generate that for you.
So if your project doesn't have that already, then you can add the new item very easily to start. And then it has some sort of defaults that populates in the file, and then you can go and switch.
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly.
Yeah. So I'm curious. So editor config, that's actually kind of like a standard thing that's used in other languages as well. It's not specific to .NET. We've just adopted it, right? I'm curious then, you know, whenever I start a new .NET project, I always just go and copy the one from the runtime and borrow theirs because I'm like, they probably know what they're talking about. So I'm going to do what they think.
Those runtime folks really know.
So I'm curious, like, how would I know, like, how to change all of those different aspects to the thing? Because there's a lot of different language specific ones. And it's like, you know, it's all a bit overwhelming. And I guess what do you suggest for that specifically?
Yeah, and we've gotten a lot of feedback about it because let's say you set, you know, tabs and you have these like rules that you want to set for your tabs, and somebody would actually type tab instead of tabs, and like we don't recognize that. The editor config files, you can make these like small little granular mistakes. And so what we are working on is building a UI to actually configure all of these, just so you can see the rules more clearly. And the options will just have these like pre-selected menu options. And we do have something similar for code style analyzers. So not for the code quality SDK ones. And that's, you know, what we're going to start building as well. And I'll just look for that in the meantime, but.
Okay. Yeah. While you're pulling that up, I was just going to say, like, it's a perfect opportunity if you're building out a UI to bury some sort of Easter egg in there. That is, you know, tabs versus spaces. You can have the formal argument there and just say that semicolons always wins.
Now, Dave, you don't want to get her in trouble, do you? I thought we quit doing Easter eggs.
So this is kind of what we have for code style analyzers, but it doesn't include code quality, and then it won't, this UI, it won't work with, you know, your CI/CD pipeline. Like, you won't be able to actually like push these changes. This is specific to your Visual Studio settings. So because we now are going to have code style, you know, work with, you know, CI/CD. So like, you can actually break builds with them because they were just built into Visual Studio. Like, now you can actually use them in VS Code, let's say, because we are going to include those in the SDK. And so then we're, you know, going to then create a UI where you can configure the code style, the code quality analyzers that are part of the SDK. A way you can also do it is just by generating this editor config. So you can just convert all of your code style rules that you set in your, you know, Visual Studio settings, and then you could then configure that. So, but yeah, stay tuned for that UI. I'm really excited about it. And, you know, we do get questions where it's like, oh, what analyzers are part of the SDK? And so now we can be like, here, this is what it is, you know, because they're sort of like hidden. Like, you can't see them unless you see them, you know, showing up in your editor through the light bulb or, yeah.
Absolutely. So. Oh, that's awesome. We did have a friend here calling attention to the fact that we should talk about regions versus no regions as well. That's another great debate. And I think we had a guest on just recently, Jason Bach, who specifically said no regions, like end regions or something like that. So, you know, there's lots of opinions out there. So I'm curious, is there any analyzers here for some of those, like you had nested if else and stuff like that, or how deep does it get? And like, what are the analyzers that come out of the box? And I guess, what are some of the lower hanging fruit, like some opportunities that you see that developers might want to write analyzers for?
Yeah, so I could share the documentation on what, you know, analyzers we currently have. And, you know, we are open source. So if you also visit our repository at the end, I'll show you where that is. It is ak.ms/Roslyn, if you want to quickly go there too. And we have all of these, you know, suggestions for analyzers and like a good way to kind of see what we're working on. You can see like our backlog. You can also see like good first issues to start with. So if, you know, folks are interested in creating some analyzers, they can also look at those issues, and we can also guide you and walk you through writing one.
Another question, yeah, I have right away is, so for your instantiation of the date time object right there, what is the year, the month, like how are you getting those little kind of like the parameter names? Mine doesn't do that. Why does yours do that?
I know. That is actually what I wanted to show next. So again, Roslyn does power analyzers. So it powers our code fixes and refactorings, but it also powers really cool tools such as these adornments that David pointed out. So these are inline type and inline parameter name hints. And these are built into the default tools of Visual Studio, but they are off by default. So David, that's probably why you don't get them. And you could turn them on though, if you just go to display inline hints. And so this is where you can turn it on. And I already have mine, but they will be off by default. And these are the different configuration options. And what's really cool is if you want, you can always toggle them on and off by pressing Alt F1 at any given moment, which is pretty awesome.
So, I'm learning so much.
Yeah, it's really awesome. And this was actually built by one of our interns. So you can build this too, pretty much. And it's really cool. I love, you know, features like this because it just helps you understand. Like, I don't understand this, but with the inline hints, you know, I do. And
I'm following along here on my own Visual Studio. Just to try it out. and just a real quick call out to anybody who like me would see like that options dialogue and be like, where was it? Don't forget that you can always search for options in, using the search box, you know, the control Q in Visual Studio.
Yeah, I always use control Q search just for everything. And I mean, I don't know why code style didn't show up. I was like getting nervous. I was like, why isn't this here? But usually like I'll just use control Q just to search and look for everything, just because there's so many options that we have that we don't have on by default. And we'll kind of, you know, ship it in the product. And a lot of them are just sort of like experimental, but we have like navigate to decompiled sources. You know, we have add missing using directs on paste, which is really cool. And so we'll kind of like release a feature in a preview just to, and we'll have it off by default just to make sure that there's, you know, a lot of folks can like dog food it first internally and see that it works really well and they don't have any complaints, and then we'll sort of release it. But if you are on preview and you want to just get the latest features, just go to the C Sharp and Visual Basic Advanced section just to check those out.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Something happened with Dave, so but let's continue.
Okay. Yeah. I don't see David, but it's fine. I mean, Ryan Reynolds. I think that, so again, Roslyn, you know, could also power things such as the inline hints. And then it also powers really cool things such as, you know, code completion, which is also known as IntelliSense completion. And so one feature that, you know, people were really excited about is the regex completion that we have. So here I have different options for all the different regex characters, as well as an explanation of what each of the characters mean. And so that's really, really awesome and just helpful because, you know, we give you this inline experience without having to go online to like learn how to write out a regex string. So that was so popular that we added this for, did you have something to say?
Oh, I was just going to say that is huge. I don't think he coined it, but Hanselman said once, you know, so you have a problem you're trying to solve with regex. Congratulations, you have two problems. This is very useful. Does this have like can we dig into that? Can we see more of this? Because I want to see like how I can compare this to like what's the tool that I use for regexes? I can picture the little green horsey icon.
Regex tester, whatever. Regex 101.
Oh wow. So does it do any kind of IntelliSense? Was there IntelliSense involved with that?
Yeah, so this is the completion list. It looks a little bit different from the IntelliSense list, but these are all the different completion options. And it lets you know what each of these do. So like this /E is escape character. So it'll just kind of give you explanations as well as like the description of these characters.
Oh, I love it.
That's amazing.
Does it just pop up when you're doing the regex, or like do you need to press anything to see the analyzer in action?
So you will need to press control space. Mm-hmm. It's kind of how you would sort of be able to use it.
Okay.
So yeah, so control space just opens up the completion list. And you know, so we got a lot of feedback for those who weren't like, just don't use regex, you know, and so people were really into it. So we decided to also add this for, you know, other things that people might have trouble writing, which is date time strings and time span literals. So again, if I press control space, I get, you know, these completion options as well as an explanation of what each of these characters mean. And I really love that this also gives you examples too.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, it's really cool.
Yeah, because like I always have to look it up in the documentation to do those. So it's like having that, like you're not like you're saving time while you're coding, right?
Yes. Yeah, and that's what we're trying to do. We're just trying to like figure out, you know, all the help we can give developers in line, you know, without having to sort of switch over and just search for how to do this. We want to sort of let you know in the moment how to do it. So it's really cool.
Are these just to make sure, these are all like included in Visual Studio. These aren't the workload. It's not like a workload we have to install or anything like that.
No, these are included in the default tools of Visual Studio 2019.
Oh, that is so cool.
Yeah. Yeah. So but when in doubt, control space, then you'll like see what you can do there.
But for these to work, do you need to go and enable the .NET Analyzer, or is that separate?
No, it's separate. So you we'll get a lot of our analyzers, especially the code style ones, and you won't even really need to enable those in Visual Studio. But if you do want the more advanced analyzers, the ones that the Roslyn team uses, and you want to learn like what the most recommended analyzers are from the experts themselves, from the Roslyn developers, you should enable those .NET analyzers. So that's for that. So it's more about like code quality, performance, security. So that's what those are for. Yeah. Yeah. So I feel like I could demo this all day just because it's really cool. And
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off, Mika. You are welcome to demo it all day because it is really cool.
Yeah, I'm loving it.
When I show this to people, a lot of people are shocked, and we're trying to figure out ways how we can make it more discoverable, to kind of like understand like your workflow. So we could offer you the right suggestions throughout your inner loop development. So that's what we're sort of working on, because, whenever I do demo this, everyone's sort of shocked about it and they're like, whoa, I didn't know you had that. So So figuring out that would be really cool too.
Does my audio work now?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know what's going on. I'm having a Monday, apparently. are you able, Mika, to share any of the actual like analyzer code itself? Because I'm curious to see what some of those like the Roslyn APIs actually look like. Because that's kind of the scary part for, I think, a lot of people looking to actually develop these is, it's nice to have the mental model of how those APIs kind of look. And any example code there is, I think, very beneficial.
Yeah, so let me close this up real quick and try to switch over to how to write these. So I'm going to first just, I know I kind of gave an introduction, today about, the syntax tree API. But again, what we're going to sort of build today is we're going to use the syntax tree API. And the analyzer that we will write today is going to identify missing braces in a statement that is not enclosed in a block that has curly braces. And then we're going to create a code fix, so that light bulb suggestion, which suggests you add braces. So switching over to here, the very first thing that you will need to do is you will need to install the .NET Compiler Platform SDK. So you can do this via the Visual Studio installer by selecting modify.
And you don't need to do it with the preview version. I noticed you're doing preview here, but you could do it with like the regular one.
I'm always using preview, but yeah, you could definitely do it on Visual Studio 2019, the regular version. And so here I already have it selected, the .NET Compiler Platform SDK. And so once you have that selected, let me see if I have, do I have this? Yes, okay. Once you have that selected, you'll want to create a new project. So you'll just launch Visual Studio. You'll select, create a new project, and then you'll just filter it on for analyzer is what I usually do. And so we have two versions. We have one for C# and one for Visual Basic, but the one that we're going to build today is going to be in C#. And so once you select that, you can select next, but I already have one open and ready to go for this demo. So once you have that, you'll see that this kind of this already comes with a template. So this template has a boilerplate, and it's for an analyzer that, I think it just makes all types uppercase. It's some sort of like dummy template that you can use. And so the two projects that I'm going to really only update today that you really only need to have to update is the Brace Analyzer project and the Brace Analyzer code fix project. So it's just these two. And then within the Brace Analyzer file over here, you can see that this pretty much will contain the analyzer implementation that reports a diagnostic. So I'm gonna be keeping a lot of this code that does that already. And the only thing that I really went ahead and updated so far is this description, message, and title for the analyzer, just to save time. So I went ahead and I already did that. So I have my title, which will enclose the braces, and then my description and message. So this is what's going to kind of show up also in the light bulb, you know, as a suggestion to add this brace. And so then if we look at the diagnostic descriptor rule, okay, I'll just close this a bit. So this is where we define what our rule is, what our analyzer rule is, and then the rule has a diagnostic severity. And so this is where you determine how you want this to manifest in the editor. So right now it's set to a warning, so it'll be a green squiggle. And you can change this, you know, if you want to an error or a suggestion. So I'm gonna just keep it though as a warning. And so the only thing that really matters that I really need to update is this initialize method pretty much. And so this is, so pretty much it gives you a context with all the information so that you can access this point. And what you're going to do is you're going to register in this function, a callback in this function. So when you, when the compiler hits a certain node or token that you specify, it's going to call that callback pretty much. And so I actually already have a snippet of code ready to go. So let me just do that real quick. And so this is, you know, for the initialize method that I'm updating here. And I might be missing a curly brace, I think. So this, so here I went ahead and I just already updated this, but so pretty much, yeah, so pretty much what I was saying before, this statement's going to iterate through all the statements in the tree. And it's going to start with the root node, and it's going to report the issues for all the statements that are nested within a statement, but not a block statement. And so in case you're wondering, like, how do I know, like, what kind of syntax to filter against? That's, you know, where the syntax visualizer tool comes into play, which allows me to explore the syntax tree that I mentioned earlier. So you can open this.
I was going to ask the question.
I already have mine. Yes, yeah.
So, because there's a lot to unpack there, right? So this, and looking at the syntax tree, this is some of the parts, you know, the APIs that are like the mystery, the wizardry, if you will, right? Mm-hmm. So that visualizer is going to be helpful. But really what this is the mental model that I have is this, this is literally taking a C-sharp file in, and this context is kind of representing that line by line or token by token. And all of those different parts of this tree are what make up your C-sharp file. And that's how the Roslyn, you know, analyzer understands it. Is that correct?
Yes, exactly. Okay. And
you know, yes. it really feels very reminiscent to me of you know, back when we would use XML reader and like parse out the individual elements and attributes in a string of XML.
Yeah, but for C-sharp and VB. So there was a question here too earlier. Roslyn, that's specific to C-sharp and VB, but not F-sharp. There was a question about F-sharp.
No, it's not. This isn't specific to F-sharp. So this only includes C-sharp and Visual Basic.
So they were asking, like, is F-sharp an option? Like, could you write analyzers for that? If so, what would you do if it's not the Roslyn compiler stuff? Or is that possible? Or I don't know.
So I guess it would be specific to the F-sharp one. And I don't know if it is, on to be quite honest. But it wouldn't be through Roslyn, since Roslyn's only the compiler for C-sharp and Visual Basic. Mm-hmm. So I definitely think it's something that we could tweet and ask about, and we could talk to the F-sharp PM and see
Absolutely.
If that is possible or will be possible in the future.
And there's a few more questions here real quick. So they're asking if they can use Roslyn analyzers to implement their own IntelliSense.
Wow. So IntelliSense is, I guess it's just a heavier topic and it's a bit more complicated. Mm-hmm. To write, but we do have, you know, issues on Roslyn on our repo for, you know, certain IntelliSense behaviors. So a good way to start would probably be to be a part of the discussions where you can just ask a question. You can also go on Discord or Gitter and just say like, hey, I'm extremely curious how to write IntelliSense, or like how, you know, I can get started and maybe like fixing an issue or adding a feature to Visual Studio's IntelliSense completion. And so the developers could then, you know, walk you through that and help you with that.
Awesome. And then one more question real quick. We've got a friend here asking if you can unit test the analyzer.
So we do have tests for analyzers as well. So this template does come with, you know, the brace analyzer test project. So you can add tests to this too.
Awesome.
So it does have unit tests. Yeah.
So you're an official developer if you write unit tests, right?
Yes.
Awesome. Cool. This is great.
Template also includes the unit test project?
Yeah, this template includes all of these projects by default. Okay. So it's the analyzer, the code fix. Then you can create a NuGet package as well. Just build it, and then you can just go ahead and publish it onto NuGet.org. And then you can create tests as well. And then this is for running the V6, which I'll talk about too.
And then before we asked you a bunch of questions, you were starting to show the visualizer, like the syntax tree and stuff like that.
Yeah, and I so we do have docs where we can get a lot deeper into this as well. But I guess if you are sort of curious, like exactly like how did I get this this identifier name, or how did I know to use block syntax? So I use the syntax visualizer. So you can just kind of highlight this block to learn the syntax for it. Which is, that's how I got block syntax. And these types, they also come with, specific properties as well. So you can learn about the type and the kind. And so I'll definitely share documentation because you can explore this forever just to kind of like understand what each of these types are and like where they are in the syntax tree as well.
So there's literally like an object called block and open brace token I'm seeing and if statement.
Yeah.
And if keyword. So it's literally parsing and building out objects that represent the entire syntax tree of what we know of as our language, right? So like that's incredible. That's awesome.
Yeah. You said it so much better than me. That's a really good description. Yeah, it's really cool. So I definitely recommend like playing around with it and seeing what you can find for sure.
Awesome.
And so yeah, and that was literally just the actual analyzer, right? That is going to report the diagnostic. But next, I just want to quickly go over the code fix that we're going to also add. And so this code fix will add those missing braces. And so this code fix will take in the diagnostic ID. So this is the same diagnostic ID that we have in our brace analyzer file. So it's already hooked in automatically with, with the boilerplate that we provide you. And so you don't have to update that. And then the register code fix async, let me close out of that. Hold on one second. So then the register code fix async is where we're registering our code fix. And then this method here, this make uppercase is what it comes with by default, but this is where we're going to invoke the fix to add the braces. So go ahead and just add that real quick. Let's see. Okay. Right. So again, this is just like a few lines of code that I added. Same with the analyzer as well, just a few lines. So these aren't super, it's not like so much code that you have to write. We really did kind of give you that boilerplate to just get started. And next we can test our analyzer, make sure it works. So I need to first make sure that the brace analyzer V6 is selected in the dropdown as the startup project. And then once that is and you want to test it, you just press F5. And pressing F5 will just open an instance of Visual Studio that already has my analyzer installed in it.
Oh, that's neat. So the way to debug it is to literally relaunch VS Instance kind of as like a sidecar, if you will.
Yes, exactly. And
it does all the wiring and configuring. There's no, oh, cool.
So like
yeah,
the debugger,
it already is configured.
So the debuggers attached too. So like if you have breakpoints over in your original source code, like those will hit and you can step through it.
Yeah.
Oh my God. I love that. That's so cool.
Yeah. And that's where that V6 project comes into place. That's like all the configurations. So you don't have to do that for you. We don't have to do that for yourself. I mean, we do that for you.
Well, I know what my afternoon is going to be spent doing now.
Let's see. So this is going to load eventually. And so like, as this does load, if you do see a squiggle, then that means that the analyzer works, which is going to be pretty cool. So this is Visual Studio running Visual Studio, pretty much.
It's like the best dog food ever, right? Like,
yeah.
and it's the C# Roslyn analyzer analyzing C#. So it's like this huge, massive, circular reference problem, which isn't really a problem because it's, you know, we're fixing the problems. That's what this is.
Yeah. Let's see if this works.
Helicopter prepared. You were so prepared. You even have sample source code where it says .NET docs shell rock.
Yeah.
That is amazing. Oh, I feel honored now.
You know, on that subject, I was just thinking we should get like Carl Franklin and Richard Campbell on our show, and then we could do the .NET docs do .NET rocks, or .NET rocks does .NET docs. Right? Carl or Richard, if you're watching, reach out to us.
That's funny. All right. So we're watching. It's there's a squiggle. Ta-da!
There's a squiggle. We got a squiggle.
Cam, you're supposed to play the music, but then it would break everyone's audio and I'd probably get kicked off.
We're not doing that again. No. Sorry. Here.
Yes! Yay! So gratifying, you know, when you write your own analyzer and you see that squiggle. Cool. And then squiggle's gone.
So that was amazing because it added braces, and it's something so simple, but in all honesty, that is one of my pet peeves when people try to not include braces. So thank you for that demo.
Yeah. And if you want to be like really sneaky, you can just like, you know, just build this, publish it to nougats.org, add it to your projects, and like make everyone conform to that, you know?
We did have a friend asking if this works on Linux. I don't know why it wouldn't.
Yeah, I don't know why it wouldn't, but yeah, this should. Yeah.
I'm trying to think about that because I mean, you're not running Visual Studio on Linux, right?
Well, you will probably just get warnings when you compile and things like that.
Yeah, I'm not totally sure, but.
Yeah, that's a good question. So to Myra's point, if you have these analyzers in place and you just simply compile this, if you have things like as warnings, those show up as legitimate compile warnings, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
You won't have like the rich UI that you have here because you would be using VS Code. And so VS Code is different than Visual Studio, right? So
yeah. I think a lot, there is a developer on our team that does, you know, write analyzers in VS Code. So there is a way. I just think when you do run the V6, I think you do have to, it does open Visual Studio to actually write it and then see your analyzer getting applied. So, but to get the actual squiggles and analyzers to like get, use them throughout your projects, you will get those in. So yeah.
Yeah, they're actually saying that they use Visual Studio Code as their C# development IDE. So that's awesome. I know that there's a lot of people that have done that, and I've been very curious, like what extensions they have in place, and you know what their experience is like with that. I tend to use Visual Studio proper for all of my C# development, and Visual Studio Code for TypeScript and stuff like that.
Yeah, there is C# extension or the OmniSharp one, and you can just install that and then you'll get all of the Roslyn analyzer goodness through that. but yeah, to develop and write to write an analyzer, I'm not totally sure, but yeah, C# development, just as long as you have the OmniSharp extension, you're good to go, or the C# extension.
Awesome. And I do know that if you were to do this yourself and write like an actual VS Code extension, I've written extensions for VS Code before, you actually, with C# specifically, you'd probably end up writing a language server. And then I'd be really curious, you know, what that would look like, you know, with the Roslyn APIs and stuff like that. We did have a friend just mentioning that they noticed we were all dressed up and they've never seen us dressed up before. So they must have missed something. Yes, it's our 1 year anniversary. Just going to state that again.
Then he said we were looking dapper. But when he said, wait, we could. Yeah, we have a graphic for that. No, he said we were looking dapper, but he spelt it DAPR, which I thought was entertaining.
Yes.
That was clever.
That was very clever. Timely.
There was someone asking about VS for Mac. So do we have those same functionalities in VS for Mac?
Yeah, so we have the analyzers in VS for Mac. And so you will, get certain code style analyzers as well, and some of the code quality ones. So it does work in VS for Mac too. So you will get a bunch of code fixes and refactorings.
Awesome.
Yeah.
We've got about 5 minutes before we close this episode out. So is there any closing thoughts, any links, resources, things like that?
Yeah, so the first one is just, this is the Roslyn repo. You can get to it at ak.ms/Roslyn, or you can just go to github.com and search through the .NET repos and look for Roslyn. You can definitely create one of these yourselves and you can contribute. And the best way to do that is to start with a question on discussion. So, we had a question earlier about writing the completion, IntelliSense completion, so you can definitely do that. Look for the discussion in our repo or ask a question. You can also ask us questions on Gitter or Discord, and we sort of recommend that you do that first before you go ahead and contribute. And we do have a guide for how to contribute also. So we do have these, a way where you can, how we will sort of accept PRs, and we'll also walk you through those PRs that you do submit as well. And then definitely follow us on Twitter. It's at Roslyn. And you can there you can also just ask the team some questions on analyzers and let us know about, we also want to know about all the cool analyzers that you're building and just spread the Roslyn love. So, yeah.
Awesome. We did have one more question here real quick. Michael was asking if it's possible to use source generators to actually generate CS files and save those to disk.
That's a really good question. I will look into that and get back to you. This is on Twitter, Michael Wan. Okay, let me look into that and let you know.
I don't know if there's a reason to. I mean, I know that like T4 would save those. You'd actually generate, based on templates to a disk, but. I've been playing around with Jared Parsons a bit on one of his repos with source generators just recently, and we were developing some attribute so that you can basically have an attribute that's automatically added to your compilation context, and then you can apply that to a class and then generate like a partial class from another partial class, and but it doesn't actually add like a CS file that's saved to disk. So that's, I'm curious about that too now.
Yeah, I'll definitely look into that. I can ask Jared and we can tweet back with our reply once I find out.
Awesome.
Yeah, or like if people still have questions, they can go to the discussions on the repo directly as well and post their question, right?
Yes. And then definitely look for any issues in the backlog that you want to upvote. If you want to find a bug, like a first, a good bug to get started with, you can also find that here too. And also if you want to learn about all of the different, code fixes and refactorings that we do have, you can go to aka.ms/refactorcode. And then this is just a bunch of our refactorings that we have and code fixes. So
there's the links in the chat. So aka.ms/refactorcode. Awesome. Well, this has been great. I learned a lot. I'm super excited to dig into this more now myself and selfishly go learn a bunch more. I always feel like every time we have a guest on, I just learn so much. So thank you for being a guest and showing us all this amazing stuff. And this was a very special episode for us, 1 year anniversary. So it went by fast. I can't believe how quick it went. Time flies when you're having fun.
Yeah. Indeed. Scott said on Twitter the other day, this was just a reminder for all our viewers. This started as just three friends sitting around. We had a departmental wide training in Seattle or Bellevue, actually, last what, January? Early February. And we were just sitting around going, oh, gee, wouldn't it be nice to start a stream? And then the pandemic happened, and here we are, a year later, and we've been doing the stream for a year. So
I will tell you that once we hit our 2 year mark, I'm not wearing a suit. I hope this is the last time I ever have to wear a suit.
we'll have to find something better for you to wear. I'm going to take that as a challenge. I'm curious
about your logo on the hat. So what is that hat?
Oh, this is a Deftones hat. I'm a huge Deftones fan. I always will be wearing some sort of Deftones attire. So it's part of my brand.
Who do we have next week, Dave?
That is a great question. I'm trying to look right now. Oh, I pressed at the same time you did.
Yep.
Bogdan, who's going to be discussing home automation. So I know you're super excited for that one, Cam.
Yes, I am. Yeah, I'm looking forward to that. He's going to be telling us about Home Assistant, which is a different system than what I use. So we'll be comparing and contrasting and debating, and I'm looking forward to it.
Awesome. Cool.
All right. Thank you, Mika, for joining us for on our anniversary.
All right.
Yeah, bye. Thank you so much for having me.
Awesome. All right, bye, friends. Is that it? We're done?
Yeah, that's it.
Bye, kids. Bye, friends.
Yeah.